Good morning, or afternoon. All right. Wasn't that an inspiring session just before? Very meaningful. Yes, thank you. Well, we got to have the ritual in the front row. This gentleman right here who's walking in has been sitting in the front row at the Parker Seminar for 31 years each time. And I don't think he's missed one. Thank you. All right, so I have the next 45 minutes or so with you, and I'm going to talk about mission and practice. And how many have never heard me speak before, just so I have an idea? Okay, a few of you, good. One message that I want to start with, and I'm going to speak to each one of you. And I'm going to speak to your heart. I want you to say to yourself from this day forward, I give myself permission to do something extraordinary on planet Earth. I give myself permission to do something extraordinary on planet Earth. For it is my destiny. So often, we compare ourselves to other people. And judge ourselves in comparison. Instead of judging our own actions to our inspiring dreams. And we sometimes assume that we're supposed to be somebody we're not. And we live in the shadows instead of on the shoulders of giants. As individuals and as an entire profession, we deserve to be on the shoulders. We have to give ourselves permission to do something extraordinary on planet Earth. We have been gifted with an insight into human wellness. We've been inspired by a philosophy that the power of healing lies within. We don't want to forsake that great wisdom. We want to share it and shine it. And exemplify it so we can do something extraordinary on planet Earth. We work with our hands, our hearts, and our minds, and we transform lives every day. The impact we have is to the degree of our congruency. How congruent are we? Every individual lives by a set of priorities, a set of values, things that are most important to least important in their lives. Whatever is highest on our values, we spontaneously are inspired from within to fulfill it. We can't wait to get up in the morning and fulfill that. If our highest value is serving through adjusting subluxations, so the power that made the body can heal the body, because we can't wait to get up in the morning and do that, people can't wait to get our service. To this day, I really believe that the greatest marketing tool we ever have is an authentic and inspired mission that's clear. Whatever is highest on our value, the ancient Greeks called the telos, the end in mind. All other activities in our life are ultimately means to that end. Napoleon Hill called it the chief aim. One of my mentors in my 20s, Ed Tellison, called it the magnificent obsession. The thing is so magnificent in your heart that you're inspired and can't imagine doing anything but that. The telos was so important to the ancient Greeks, they made a study of it. And they called it teleology. Jim Parker, for many decades, taught the science of being naturally right, teleology. Teleology stands for the study of meaning and purpose. When we live congruently and in alignment with our highest values, not only are we inspired to get up and do and fulfill that, but we feel it's the most meaningful thing, the most inspiring thing, the most magnificent thing we can do. It's our purpose. Our purpose, when lived congruently, initiates an expansion of who we are. Every time we set a goal that's aligned and congruent with the highest value, the telos, our space and time horizons expand. Our vision becomes crystal clear. The primary thing that stops us from living by the telos is that subordination to outer influence. That's why one of the great philosophers said, I'd rather have the whole world against me than my own soul. Your telos is the direct line to the soul, the state of unconditional love for your life, because when you're doing what you really love every day and you're inspired by it, you feel grateful and you have grace and you're inspired. And every human being on the planet is magnetically attracted to anybody who's exemplifying this authenticity. Our patients are magnetized through the science of being naturally right when we're authentic and congruent and we're inspired and clear on our mission of service. In the Book of Wealth by Hubert Hale Bancroft, he mentioned three great principles that stood for the greatest wealth in the world, the individuals, organizations, and institutions that achieved great wealth. And one of them was that they felt by divine providence and human sovereignty that they were destined to serve vast numbers of people. When a person is living congruently with what's truly meaningful to them, they automatically expand their space and time horizons. They automatically are service-oriented. They automatically look for challenges because they can embrace support and challenge equally in the pursuit of their purpose. And they love tackling the challenges of making a difference in the world serving people. And they have a yearning, almost a feeling of impossibility not to make the difference, a destiny factor when they are automatically congruent. So if we allow ourselves to do something extraordinary on planet Earth, and we allow ourselves to be authentic and not subordinate to the outer influence. As Emerson said, envy is ignorance and imitation is suicide. And as Einstein said, my contempt for authority is what made me one. We're not here to subordinate to anyone, not our individually and not collectively, not any other institution, not any other profession. We're to honor the uniqueness of the chiropractic mission and message and bring that to the world. And live authentically, because if we do and if we exemplify it, as Einstein said, the greatest teacher is exemplification and doctors are teachers. If we live with exemplification, it's impossible for people not to be magnetized and drawn to us and pulled to us in the naturally right state, as Jim used to say. And we attract the clients that match us. Every time we set a goal that's aligned with our values, we have the highest probability of achievement. Our identity revolves around that highest value. And we achieve, and every time we achieve, we give ourselves permission to expand a greater achievement, bigger in space, bigger in time, until our vision goes beyond our local community to our city, to our state, to our nation, to our world and beyond. And the greater our vision, the easier it is to manifest our outcome. I've said on this stage many times, if we want to make a difference in ourselves, we have to have a vision at least as big as our family. We want to make a difference in our family, we have to have a vision as big as our community. We want to make a difference in our community, we need a vision as big as our city. We want to make a difference in our city, we need a vision as big as our state. We want to make a difference in our state, we need a vision as big as our nation. If we want to have a national influence, we need a global vision. And if we want to leave a global impact on this planet and leave a legacy here that's an immortal legacy, we have to have an astronomical vision. We have to be a celestial soul looking down on a terrestrial mind and go do something extraordinary on planet Earth. And we have to give ourselves permission from an authentic state, from the telos, to live a chiropractic message and mission and vision and let nothing on the outside stop from the vision from the inside. If we do, no mortal can interfere with our immortal vision. Because the magnitude of our space and time continues to expand until it extends beyond our own mortal existence. And there's something magnetism that we have when we're in that state. We draw and magnetize people. We synchronize. We're at the right place, right time to meet the right people and synchronize. The second we're authentic. I was in Tokyo recently, and I met with a gentleman who took over his father's company, manufacturing clothes, and he was inspired and felt he could do something even greater with the company, and now he's taken it to be the largest manufacturer of clothes in the world. And I had a meeting with him because he's incorporating some of my methodologies throughout his company around the world. And he was telling me about his mission. And when he shared his mission, he got tears in his eyes, and you could see it in his eyes. A chiropractor who is inspired and is congruent and is authentic and is focused on serving, you can see it in their eyes. His global outreach with his clothes was because his mission did not have hesitations. The cloudiness of our vision is based on all the injected values of others we subordinate to. When we stand on the shoulders and there's no subordination, we see our vision. Our vitality in life is directly proportionate to that vision. But every detail left out of that vision, because of the injections, becomes the obstacle and challenge we face in the manifestation of that vision on the earth. But he manifested a global impact because he was clear. I've been asked in leadership conferences, is this something that we're born with or something we can develop? The answer is both. Many people have the potentiality of great leadership, but because they subordinate to so many outer influences, they don't give themselves permission to be authentic, and they don't set goals that are really, truly them. Your practice will automatically, spontaneously expand the moment we are authentic. We just have to have a real mission of serving. She beautifully said, you can't fake that. So true. I had dinner with a gentleman, Bill Pollack, who owns Drake International Corporation. He's in his late 80s now. He told me at a French restaurant in Sydney, Australia, he said, in 1951, I opened up my business, and that was the last day I ever went to work. Because once I found out what my calling is, it's never been work. I can't wait. As Warren Buffett says, I tap dance to work. This gentleman does not look his age. You get a timeless mind and ageless body when you become present. And you become present when you're inspired and living congruently with your highest values. You don't notice time and space. You're present. Jim Parker used to call present time consciousness. You're grateful. He used to call that approbation. You're in the love concept. You love what you're doing. And you have certainty because you're not wavering with outside influences. You're coming from within. It's a very powerful state. Peter Lynch used to be with Fidelity. He said there are four things that are common to great companies. After he did his technical analysis and fundamental analysis of companies and looked at book values and price earnings, etc., he would go and visit the companies that he thought had merit, and he would look for four things. He looked for people who worked in the company who were grateful for their job, loved what they were doing, inspired by the vision, and enthusiastically working. This is called engagement. Nobody goes to work for the sake of a job. They go to work to fulfill their highest value, their telos. And anytime they can see that whatever they're doing is helping them fulfill their telos, they're inspired at work. They're creative. They take ownership of the job. They come up with solutions. You cannot stop a company from growing. You can't stop a practice from growing the second the people are with those four states. They're grateful for their job, they love what they're doing, they're inspired by the vision, and it's clear, and they know what they're dedicated to, and they're enthusiastically working. Time times intensity gives results. The more intensely they focus, the more they cluster their activities, the more empowered they are, the more powerful that magnet in attracting naturally right patients. I've had my stinking thinking ingratitude attitude in my office, and I've had people dissipate, and I've also been on track and on target and on tune and on time and focused, and I've seen the telephones ring and people come in. The universe rewards authenticity. The universe rewards congruency. It rewards exemplification. Larry, who just introduced me, I've known for about 30, 31 years. And he asked me to speak at his own programs many years ago. And I'm very grateful for that. And I'm going to share a story of what happened at his program that'll apply to what my message is today. I was in New York speaking at his conference at a Marks and Management program that he was providing. He had about 400 well-dressed doctors and staff in a room. It was first class. And I was the guest speaker, so I was finally led up and introduced and started speaking. About 45 minutes into my first session, which is about an hour and a half, way in the back of the room, I saw a gentleman come in late. Everybody else was prompt. This gentleman came in late, and he had a lime green suit on. Everybody else had black and blue suits and gray suits, and this gentleman came in a lime green suit. Looked like something from maybe the 70s. He sat way in the back, and I was speaking, and I noticed him. I couldn't help but see him because he just stood out. And I was talking about prioritizing what you do in your practice. As long as you do low priority things, you'll have a low priority practice. You have to make a list of everything you do in your practice and look at how much it is meaningful, how much it produces, how much it serves. Then create a column on how much does it cost to replace somebody to do that for you and how much time is spent. It's wise to prioritize what you do and identify the most important thing you can do as a chiropractor and make sure you delegate low priority things or lower priority things to other people so you can surround yourself with people who are inspired to do the things that are necessary and essential, but not by you. Because as long as you do low priority actions and do the XYZs and not the ABCs, you will lower your self-worth and net worth, and you will literally let the universe know that you don't have order yet, and it draws less patients to you. You have to prioritize and live by the ABCs if you want to grow self-worth and outreach. And I was talking about how important it is to your number one focus is the mission of sharing your mission and your message and your vision with people. And that is then locating and adjusting subluxations on people and caring about humanity. And I shared some stories about some cases in my practice that were heart-opening. Some of you have heard those stories before, from the boy who was in a coma and they came out of a coma to the boy who was blind that could see, etc. And then I had a break. And when I finished at the break, I came back up on stage. That gentleman in the lime green was sitting in the front row. Now he stood out. He's right in front of me. And as I was speaking on the next hour and 15 minutes, he's leaning over and he's crying. Because I told him that you never want to forget the moment you were called into the profession, the moment you were awakened and tapped on the shoulder by your mission and accessed that mission. Because those without a mission, those without a vision, those without a message, they perish. And somehow what I said to him made him cry. And here he was crying. His eyes were tearing, his nose was dripping, he was just leaning over. And when I finished my session, he came up to me and put his arms around me and cried on my shoulder, just snotted all over it. Tall guy. And then he walked off sort of in a daze. Well, that was a Thursday when I spoke. I went on Friday to go to another city, and I spoke on the weekend somewhere else, and on Monday I was back in my practice. And about 5 o'clock on Monday, I get a call. Well, first I get my assistant came up and said, there's a doctor on the phone, he really insists on chatting with you. And I said, okay, well, who is it? He said his name. I said, well, I don't remember his name, but I get on the phone with him, and he says, Dr. DeMartini, you may or may not remember me, but I met you last Thursday. He says, I was the gentleman that came up to you after you did your speech and gave you a big hug with tears in my eyes. And I went, yeah, I remember you. He said, thank you. I said, what happened? He said, just thank you. Your speech got to me. You see, Dr. DeMartini, I graduated from chiropractic college 10 years ago. And when I graduated, I always thought doctors that went to seminars, if they had to go to seminars, they weren't very good. I thought if I was good at what I do, people would just come in and find me. Well, I went out into practice, and Dr. DeMartini, I have floundered for a decade. I've struggled for a decade. My wife is a teacher. If it wasn't for her teaching income, I wouldn't be in practice. The most I've ever seen is 18 patients. I average 9 a day. Last week, I was really having a rough time. And I was thinking that I would be better off for my family dead with an insurance policy than continuing the way it's going. I was considering taking my life. I happened to talk to a couple buddies, and they said, instead of taking your friggin' life, why don't you go learn how to be a chiropractor and go to a seminar and learn how to grow your practice? He says, I've never been willing to do that, but when I hit bottom, I decided it's time I better do that before I take my life. So I heard about this seminar that Larry Markson was putting on. And I had this preconceived idea about seminars. And I drove for almost 6.5 to 7 hours to get to that seminar from where I live. I was driving in the same car that I graduated from chiropractic college in because I haven't been able to afford a new car. When I pulled up in the parking lot, I was so embarrassed I saw people I even graduated with. I was so embarrassed that I'd pull way out in the back of the parking lot, away from everybody, while they were all going in. I sat in my parking lot, and I ducked down low so nobody could see me. And I looked over the steering wheel until everybody was in. And it took me almost a half hour to gain the courage to walk in there. But I thought, if I don't go in there, I'm going to kill myself. So I finally got in there and I walked in. And I came in the back of the room. And I told him, I remember when he came in. And I had a preconceived idea about these people speaking at these seminars. And there you were, this fast-speaking, wiry, skinny guy talking about the cosmic AT&T system and about if you're clear on your mission, you're going to draw patients to you. And I thought, this guy's nuts. And I was just about to walk out. And you said that I didn't choose chiropractic, it chose me. And never forget the moment you were chosen. And you had me. And that moment, I wanted to go and listen to what you had to say. And so at the break, I came running to the front and grabbed a seat at the front. I just felt like you were talking to me. Nobody else was in the room that day. Well, Dr. DeMartini, you got to me. Because when I left that room, I got in my car, you told me that if my innermost dominant thought was my patients, their innermost dominant thought would be my practice. And if I don't think about them, I don't bring about them. And you told me to, if whatever you number of patients you can rattle off the top of your head is the number of patients you'll average in a day. And if you can't think about them, if you don't know their names, you don't know their families, you don't know their children, you don't know their subluxations, you don't know what's going on in their life, you're not really caring about them. Because if you care about them, they're at the tip of your mind. So all the way back, I sat there and I tried to remember every patient I've ever served since I opened in 10 years. And I wrote them down on a piece of paper as I was driving. And I was just thinking in my mind, I just can't wait to go back and serve these people. I want to put my hands and my heart and my mind on, like you said. I have not felt that way since I first started chiropractic college. I wanted to go back to that practice. You said that if you don't have order and organization, your patients go somewhere else. They automatically circulate like money. It circulates from those who value it least to those who value it most. There, wherever there's least order to that which is most order, people go wherever they're not appreciated and wherever there's least order, and they go from there to the place where it's most organized. So I went back to my office. I did not go home. Up until that day, I did not feel I deserved my wife. But on that drive home, I felt I was going to make a difference. I felt renewed. I went to my office. I didn't go home. I went to my office and I cleaned my entire office. I got patient files ready. I got prepared for patients. I started memorizing patients' names. I started thinking about them. I started seeing in my mind's eye every detail. Like you said that if you can see from the time they call to the time they refer, and you can see every detail, any detail you leave out is the obstacle you face. You said, if you can see it all, you can manifest it all. I sat and I visualized that and sat in my office and cleaned it and visualized patients there and everything was going to say, everything that they were going to say. How is it going to respond? I got prepared. I've never done that in my practice. I was so inspired that when I got home, I hugged my wife. I felt that I deserved her. Well, Dr. DeMartini, I was in my office today. I saw 52 patients. People that were not scheduled showed up. People that were not referred. People walking came by. People I hadn't seen in all this time, the people I thought about on the drive here showed up. This cosmic AT&T system is real.
So thank you for giving my life back. Thank you for reawakening my mission and vision and message of chiropractic, because right now, nothing's going to stop me now. I now know what's possible. We got to give ourselves permission to do something extraordinary on planet Earth. Well, he inspired me as much as I think I inspired him. So it doesn't matter what you've gone through, doesn't matter where you come from, doesn't matter what you're going through. What matters is your mission. And if you haven't got clear on that mission, I'd get on your knees and I would sit there in humbleness and I would say, dear divine order, divine intelligence, innate intelligence, universal intelligence, guide me, direct me. Let's get on track and on target and on tune with what my mission is. Because as B.J. Palmer says, there's the bigness of the person within. There's something more profound on the inside than there will ever be on the outside. When I was 18 years old, I attempted to go back to school. Some of you know I was told I would never be able to read or write or communicate, never amount to anything, never go very far in life. So I went back and I tried school, and I failed my first test. I'd passed the entrance exams by guessing, but when I actually took a test for the classes, I failed. My vision was shattered. I just wanted to study the laws of the universe, and I wanted to be a teacher, healer, and philosopher, and I wanted to travel the world. I didn't know about chiropractic really yet. But when I failed that test and was driving home, I was crying. And I got home and I curled up under a Bible stand, which sits in my office today. And I sat there really in a dark moment. And my mom came home and she saw me there crying. And she said, "Son, what happened?" I said, "I blew it. I failed the test. I guess I don't have what it takes. I guess I'll never read or write or communicate, never amount to anything, never go very far in life." She didn't know what to say. But finally, she said something that only a mother probably could say. She said, "Son, whether you become a great teacher, healer, and philosopher and travel the world like you dream, whether you return to Hawaii and ride big waves like you've done, or you return to the streets and panhandle as a bum like you've also done, I just want to let you know that your father and I are going to love you no matter what. I learned the love concept. What Jim Parker was talking about, the love concept, is real. When you love what you're doing in your practice, there's something special in that practice. You transform a manipulation into a true adjustment. You take and extract out space and time from your mind and become present with the soul." And in that moment, when she said that, I cried, my hand went into a fist, and I looked up and I saw my vision again. That vision that I saw is painted in my office today. If you ever come to my office, it's me speaking in front of a million people. And with my hand in my fist, I said, I'm gonna master this thing called learning. I'm going to master this thing called studying and reading. Master this thing called healing and philosophy. I'm going to do whatever it takes. I'm going to travel whatever distance. I'm going to pay whatever price to give my service of love across planet Earth. I'm not going to let any human being on the face of the Earth, not even myself, stop me from my mission. And when I said that, there was no turning back. I got up, I hugged my mom, I went into my room, and I started to get a dictionary out, and I learned how to read. And I started memorizing 30 words a day until I could pass school and excel. That love concept transformed life. When you have a patient walk in your office and you have the love concept, you cannot not transform their life. Because every human being desires to live from that authentic state, then by you exemplifying it, there's a magnetic power that you have that automatically draws more people. They can't wait to want to refer. You have the God within, the spirit within, and the enthusiasm within that's not stoppable. Well, I took off in school. And I wanted to be a teacher, healer, and philosopher. And when I found chiropractic, I knew that was the pathway of the healing arts. Even though I was in undergraduate pre-med, because that was the only path they had, I never felt there was an excess of organs or a deficiency of drugs. I believed that there was a power within the body that could heal the body. And there was an adjustment. When I found out about chiropractic, I fell in love with it. I read the chiropractic story by Marcus Bach, and I saw that, and I went in there, had tears in my eyes. I said, this is the path of healing arts that I am dedicated to. And so today, I'm a teacher, healer, and philosopher traveling the world, stepping foot on countries around the world. You never give up on your mission. You let nothing stop you from your mission. When I was in chiropractic college, I was blessed to be able to use quite a few of the treatment rooms in the clinic. I did very well in the clinic. I helped other doctors get through their credits. I had a CA actually working for me there. But I saw so many wanting to pass a test instead of fulfill a mission. Don't settle for mediocrity. Every day, every week, every month, every year, give yourself permission to raise the standards. I've said there's five S's of leadership. Know what your service in the world is. Gain specialized knowledge in it. Dedicate your life to being a master of adjusting, a master of procedures, master of philosophy, a master of practice building. Master it. No option. When they were interviewing Warren Buffett about what he loves to do, he has delegated everything else away except what he loves doing, which is reading every day and thinking and analyzing and doing what he does best. You need to get and extract out of everything you do down to the highest priority things. When I was in practice, I realized the most significant thing I could do is going sharing the message, breakfast, lunch, or dinner with groups of people to enroll new patients and train doctors to help me in all the procedures and then adjust the highest priority patients. Anything less than that needs to be delegated. Because you won't be inspired unless you're doing what you're here to do. And the moment you do, you won't be able to stop the expansion because it's innate. It is our nature. It is our destiny to expand. And we're not here to subordinate as an individual or as a profession. And I'm seeing some of this as I'm traveling. I'm seeing some subordination of our own profession to other professions. I don't want to be second to another profession. I want to be first as a chiropractor. Because the second you subordinate, you will inject the values of others into your consciousness. You will cloud the clarity of your own mission. You will miss out on the magnificence of what you have that's unique. I've asked millions of people in speaking around the world, how many of you want to make a difference? Every hand goes up. Even in prisons, they have this. Governments. Our hierarchy of values are completely unique. So if we're living truly, authentically, and congruently with our highest values, there is no two people with the same set of values. So if you want to make the greatest difference, just be authentic to yourself. Being inspired by your own unique mission, knowing that you will probably get ridiculed, violently opposed, and even fought against by fulfilling it, will eventually leave you self-evident with a new paradigm, a new convention of thinking. You got to give yourself permission to be that extraordinary person. Anything less than that is a lie. When somebody asked me, where do I see the profession going in the future? I said, if you're asking me, you're not a leader. Because if you were a leader, you would tell me. So my time is up, so I'm going to leave on this note. Give yourself permission to do something extraordinary on planet Earth. You're part of something bigger than what we even comprehend with our educated mind. Out of the entire universe, the most significant thing ever found in the universe is a brain. Most complex, differentiated, most amazing thing that's ever been discovered in the universe, the brain. And the brain has a life influence. It coordinates and governs and masters the entire body. And that's the most intricate thing that's ever been discovered. And this mental impulse is something, as a chiropractor, we specialize in. We specialize in the most magnificent structure. We specialize in the most magnificent expression. And we do it with the most amazing body on planet Earth. So let's go forward from that perspective, that we have something special on planet Earth as a mission and a message and a vision to share. And let nothing on the planet stop us from fulfilling our mission. Thank you.